In 1945, the United States dropped 2 atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan, killing in total around 200,000 people. We will never know the exact number. One might be inclined to think that deadly radiation killed many people in cancer over decades. And while that is true, those represent a small share of the total deaths. Most died from the initial explosion and from burns and damaged buildings during the first few weeks after the blast. Of course, the bombs over Hiroshima and Nagasaki came at what would be the end of the war. Rescue efforts, re-establishing of hospitals and other services, and radiation fallout cleanup efforts could be enforced relatively short after the impacts. Some of it sponsored by the nation that dropped the bombs themselves. Usage of nuclear weapons earlier in a conflict, where people were unable to flee and protect oneself from the dangerous radioactive fallout that is the most spreadable and potent in the first few weeks after an attack, could result in a higher number of casualties over time. And the bombs dropped over Hiroshima and Nagasaki were quite small by modern standards. Of course, with improved building materials, people able to seek shelter indoors would be safer than in 1945, in the case of a nuclear attack against a major city. But a bomb 10 times larger, or even more, could counteract that. Not the least in a modern city with significantly higher population density than in 1945, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The war in Ukraine has once again brought the question of nuclear weapons back. But how has the number of nuclear warheads developed over time? As we know, the United States did not drop its program after World War II, but expanded it during the coming decades. We were to adjust to a world with a Cold War, atomic bomb testing, and nuclear attack drills. The world had, by the 1950s, gone nuclear and would never look back. In 1949, the US had 170 nuclear warheads. But by then, it was no longer alone in the world. The efforts to acquire nuclear capabilities in the Soviet Union had been successful, and it now joined the Cold War race against its adversary. By 1953, the United Kingdom became the third nation on this map. Here, every yellow, pink, and orange marker represent 10 nuclear warheads. A nation with the stockpile below 10 is visualized with a white marker. By the late 1950s and early 1960s, the United States ramped up its number of warheads significantly, passing 20,000 in 1961. By then, the Soviet Union had 2,500 at its disposal. China and France gained their first in 1964, and the US passed 30,000 in 1965. Israel got its first in 1967. By the early 1970s, the Soviet Union started catching up, and by then the US had peaked and had started to retire some of its acquired arsenal. On this map, we show all the warheads of the Soviet Union on what is Russia's territory today, but a sizable share of them were distributed across its republics. By 1978, the Soviet Union had the most in the world, with 26,000. And the US was down at 24. South Africa joined the game in 1982, and the Soviet stockpiles peaked in 1986, with over 40,000 nuclear warheads. That also meant the peak of the world as a whole, with 64,000. In the following 10 years, that would be cut in half. South Africa ended its program in 1990, and the Soviet Union collapsed. By 1998, India and Pakistan gained nuclear capabilities, and by 2004, neither the US nor Russia had more than 10,000 warheads. North Korea is thought to have reached nuclear capabilities in 2015, and since then, the global number has been stable at around 9,000. Around 3,700 for the US and 4,400 for Russia. These numbers exclude warheads queued for dismantlement. Including those would add on a couple of thousands for Russia and the US respectively. These numbers also treat all nuclear warheads equally, even though they vary in size and range significantly, as well as in time required to deploy. Nuclear warheads can be deployed by missiles, planes, or submarines, not all equally effective in all situations. Many more aspects than the actual number of warheads should be considered when assessing a nation's nuclear capabilities. Much of the reduction in numbers is a result of treaties signed by both the US and Russia. But while the trend is clear, the last decade has shown that extending nuclear disarmament agreements and establishing new ones has been associated with more difficulty. The world is also a different place today when it comes to nuclear bomb testing. These are the number of tests in a 5-year period since the end of World War II. During the last 25 years, North Korea is the only nation to have tested nuclear weapons. One can see nuclear weapons as the ultimate example of devastating human means of warfare. A constant risk of ending the human civilization as we know it, in the hands of potentially unstable leaders that is just one miscommunication away from pressing the button. And there is no doubt that the nuclear weapons currently active in the world could kill hundreds of millions of people. Not only as a direct result of the impacts themselves and the radioactive fallout, but also as a result of what would probably follow in the years after a full-scale nuclear war, a so-called nuclear winter. This is a term used to describe a scenario where so much dust is launched into the atmosphere in a short time that the sunlight reaching the Earth is greatly reduced during several years. This could cause massive disruptions to agriculture and a worldwide famine, potentially killing many times more than the blast themselves. On the other hand, nuclear weapons have been in the arsenal of the world's greatest military powerhouses for decades upon decades, times with many close calls, infected situations, and changes in leadership. Yet, no bombs have been dropped. Nuclear weapons could be the ultimate deterioration from war. If you know that your adversary has nuclear weapons at their disposal, would you think once more before striking? Are the nuclear warhead stockpiles the ultimate explanation of the so-called long peace between great powers since World War II? Maybe. Just as it is difficult to quantify a lack of disease, a lack of poverty, and a lack of natural disasters, we will never know what the world would have looked like without the invention and adaption of nuclear weapons as a founding part of the world's arsenal of war. Just as it is difficult to say that deterrence did not play a role during the Cold War, just as it is difficult to say it does not play a role in Ukraine in 2022. It is also a bit fraught to say that we have lived in an uninterrupted period of peace for the last 75 years. Depending on where you live in the world, that might not be your experience. And in many of the wars we have seen, many of them devastating without coming close to World War II, the great powers have been involved. Definitely so, more than just indirect. Japan today has come far from those devastating days in August of 1945. But the memory is still vivid in a city like Hiroshima. Japan is today surrounded by nations in possession of nuclear weapons, in Russia, China, and North Korea to the west, and of course its ally, the United States, on the other side of the Pacific. And despite a long-term stance for nuclear disarmament and against proliferation, Japan today probably stands with its peaceful nuclear power program and strong cooperation with its nuclear allies in NATO, closer to nuclear weapons than ever before. Whether that will result in developing its own, hosting US warheads, or no change at all, is hard to say. But the world went nuclear. And as far as we know today, will remain for much longer. Nuclear weapons is an important, though not dominating, part of some nations' military capabilities. By following the link in the description, you can see my video on military spendings in general. You can also subscribe to my channel to see more videos in the future on similar topics. I'll see you in the next one.